Hi, my name is Pradeep Natarajan. I'm the Director of Preventive Cardiology at Mass General Hospital in Boston, Massachusetts. The title of this talk is Secondary Prevention, Aspirin, and Low-Dose Anticoagulation. The key takeaways of this talk are to recognize that aspirin represents the standard antithrombotic therapy for secondary prevention, to identify clinical differences across aspirin dose and preparations, and to identify anticoagulants demonstrated to be clinically efficacious for secondary prevention in addition to aspirin. Willow bark was first recognized for its medicinal properties approximately 500 years ago. The active ingredient in willow bark for its medicinal properties is aspirin. You can see over the course of the timeline, its evolving use, including for the treatment of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Ultimately, research in aspirin identified that the key mechanism by which it protects against cardiovascular disease was inactivating an enzyme called cyclooxygenase, which is important in the activation of platelets. Now, through advances in clinical trials, particularly in the late 20th century, it was ultimately observed that aspirin in multiple clinical trials was shown to be beneficial for preventing recurrent coronary artery disease events among patients who had established coronary artery disease. Across the world, there have been significant practice differences in the dosing of aspirin used to prevent recurrent events among patients who have stable coronary artery disease. Because of the challenges of the different doses across the world, individuals used what are called pragmatic clinical trials, novel clinical trials that leverage differences in the practice pattern as well as randomization to really test the hypothesis, what is the best dose of aspirin for chronic coronary artery disease? You'll see in this recent clinical trial, it was observed that the efficacy for preventing recurrent cardiovascular disease events was very similar for individuals who were treated with 81 milligrams of aspirin versus 325 milligrams of aspirin. Obviously, those who were treated with 81 milligrams of aspirin versus 325 milligrams of aspirin had lower gastrointestinal bleeding rates. And so, in the United States, we primarily use 81 milligrams of aspirin to prevent recurrent cardiovascular disease events in stable patients. Now, in addition to the dosing, there are regular preparations of aspirin. There are also enteric coating preparations of aspirin, with the notion that maybe a separate coating on the aspirin pill may help prevent the rates of GI bleeding. Now, that has not borne out well in clinical studies. You'll see here also a test on whether there's a difference in the antiplatelet effect between enteric-coated and regularly prepared aspirin. At the top is thromboxane levels. It's an important readout of aspirin activity. That's just the baseline. There's some random variation, but no difference across the groups. And then at the bottom, after 14 days of being treated with placebo, non-enteric-coated, that's the second one on your left, and then the rest are different enteric-coated preparations, you'll see that thromboxane levels are a little bit higher among the individuals who are treated with enteric-coated aspirin. So in general, we try to recommend not using enteric-coated aspirin unless there is some reason, some clinical reason, that regular dose aspirin cannot be tolerated, because there is a concern that clinical efficacy could be reduced with enteric-coated preparations. Now, importantly, in the context of an acute cardiovascular disease event, it requires the interplay between clotting factors as well as the antiplatelets. That is why during an acute event, we treat patients with both antiplatelets as well as anticoagulants. As I've told you, for decades and centuries, there has been a recognition that antiplatelets are important for the management for chronic coronary artery disease, in addition to its use in the acute setting. Because of the benefit of anticoagulants treating the clotting factors in the acute setting, there's been a lot of interest and a lot of research to understand whether there is a role in the chronic management of coronary artery disease. Now, many of those studies looking at anticoagulants to prevent recurrent events for chronic coronary artery disease were often limited by high rates of bleeding. And so investigators more recently have focused on lower dose anticoagulants, namely rivaroxaban, which is a selective direct factor Xa inhibitor, at a dose of 2.5 milligrams twice a day. This is much lower than the dose that is used to treat to prevent the risk of systemic thromboembolism. Investigators showed in addition to aspirin, rivaroxaban does reduce the risk of recurrent cardiovascular disease events among patients with coronary artery disease, with the maximal benefit being rivaroxaban plus aspirin. Now, not surprisingly, with the addition of an anticoagulant, even low dose, on top of an antiplatelet, there is a greater risk of major bleeding, including a twofold risk of gastrointestinal bleeding. So there's a lot of interest in trying to identify what are the subgroups where the risk and benefit may be most optimal for treating with rivaroxaban in addition to low-dose aspirin. Now, individuals with peripheral arterial disease, atherosclerosis, typically in the lower extremities, have a very high rate of cardiovascular disease events and morbidity and mortality related to major adverse limb complications. Because these individuals are at greater absolute cardiovascular disease events, there's an observation that those individuals seem to also have a greater benefit from rivaroxaban, both from the cardiovascular disease event perspective on the left panel, as well as the limb event perspective on the right panel. And so in 2018, in addition to the doses that are used to prevent the complications of atrial fibrillation and venous thromboembolism, low-dose rivaroxaban, 2.5 milligrams twice a day, was approved in the U.S. For patients with stable coronary artery disease, as well as stable peripheral arterial disease. Now, who should be prescribed rivaroxaban in addition to aspirin? Much of this requires an assessment of risk, both on the bleeding side as well as potential clinical efficacy. First, on the bleeding side, importantly, there are many patients with coronary artery disease and atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease in general who have a separate indication for an anticoagulant, or who have a separate indication for another antiplatelet because of a recent procedure. All of these factors will influence whether individuals would be appropriate for another low-dose anticoagulant. Usually in those settings, that may lead to increased risk and increased bleeding, and may be deferred for the time. Atherosclerosis burden in chronic stable patients may help identify the individuals for whom rivaroxaban may be particularly beneficial. And these may be the patients with peripheral artery disease, with or without coronary artery disease. And importantly, those who don't also need another antiplatelet, or those who are not already taking a full-dose anticoagulant. So in summary, aspirin is the mainstay antithrombotic for secondary prevention. Aspirin 81 milligrams daily is the preferred dose. Rivaroxaban 2.5 milligrams twice daily is clinically efficacious for secondary prevention in addition to aspirin, but at the expense of greater bleeding. So absolute benefit of add-on rivaroxaban may be greatest among patients with peripheral arterial disease, with or without coronary artery disease. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this educational video helpful.